All right, everybody, welcome. We are so excited to see you all here for the Force for Good panel. We have about an hour for this is all our wonderful guest speakers. Normally, I would go through each one and give a colorful introduction, but just but then I'd have the hour would be up and I'd have to let you go. So we're going to dig right into the panel because what you have here is an all-star panel of experts when it comes to creators, psychiatrists, media experts, activists. This is a really fantastic opportunity for you to hear people talk about one of the most pressing issues in media today. And also, this is going to be an opportunity for you to speak. We're going to go through everybody relatively quickly. Everybody's going to make a short statement. And then after that, there's a microphone right over there. And we'll be taking any questions you might have yourself or our speakers. So the theme of our panel today is a force for good. And we call it that deliberately, because we're at an amazing point right now with representations of mental health in media, where you're not just passive consumers anymore. You have a voice, you're empowered, and things are changing in terms of how people with mental health issues are represented in our media. And I wanted to start talking a bit with our first expert, Janina Scarlet, who has something called superhero therapy. And I wanted to know how you use superheroes, comics as a medium to make people feel positive about their situation.
So I'm incorporating characters from comic books, as well as other works of fiction, like fantasy, science fiction, into therapy to help people feel a little bit more understood and a little bit less alone. So just to kind of help you guys understand a little bit about what I do, please raise your hand if you've ever felt like you were the only one going through something. No one's turn around, just kind of look around, put your hands up. Okay, that's everybody. And the thing is, when we're going through a hard time, maybe it's a heartbreak, maybe we're going through depression, maybe we're experiencing overwhelming anxiety, that experience alone is painful, but then on top of it, it can feel extremely alienating. Now, how many of you have ever read a comic or seen a TV show and you're like, oh, that's exactly what I've been through? And that's why we love them, that's why we love these characters. So my goal for our superhero therapy is to help people identify with heroes that they admire, and then also understand that they're not alone in going through that experience. By doing that, I'm hoping to take away the victim label and give people the empowerment label so that they can become the very hero that they admire.
Excellent. And so thank you very much. Our next speaker, Darryl Cunningham, the perfect entrance has just arrived. And I wanted to ask you, as we're talking about media representation in mental health, about your work, Psychiatric Tales, and what drew you to write about that and what you were trying to accomplish with it.
My background before I began with the students of the world, for many years on an acute psychiatric ward. And something, when I met a member of the general public who didn't know that well, I don't know how you work in that area. I realized that people do you have a clue about what that world was, what it entailed. So while I was doing this job, got a kind of dying events, because I felt eventually I would be a good book of some sort. I didn't realize it was going to be a cartoon book. And so the book that eventually came out was a book sort of divided up into sections, explaining things like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, some extent of dementia, that kind of thing. I found when I started, before I got published, before I started putting these chapters online, I started to get such a huge response from people between that. Hundreds and then thousands of people hit such a chord. Eventually, publishers came to me, I never offered to any publisher in such a way. And one of the emails that I always struck me about was a young man who was struggling with bipolar disorder, and he wanted to buy two copies of the book, one for his parents, to explain to them that he was suffering an actual illness and was interested to hear the reasons. For that reason,
thank you very much. And it's another example of people who are using the medium Janina's superhero therapy and Darryl's psychiatric tales, two compelling examples of people using the medium to help people deal with mental health issues and become stronger through it. But I think one of the things that we know in interaction with media is that not all representations of mental health are positive or are ideally the sort of thing we'd like to see. So I want to show you a quick excerpt from a new trailer for the TV show Gotham. Broadcast Thought. This is Pozios. Thank you for being on and ask their thoughts on this issue.
Well, my thoughts on the issue, can you hear me?
No.
Is that there is a great potential for more accurate, less stigmatizing representations of mental health and people with mental illnesses. And something that that I did was create a short story called Aura, which is available in a comic book anthology called Rise, Comics Against Bullying, of which I think there are copies here. There's free copies for those that want one, I think on the back table. And really my goal was to create a character who happens to be a superhero that depicts relatively realistically, or as realistically as possible, what it's like to live with a mental illness. And you know, you hear the word representation a lot, and I want to talk a little bit about that. You know, representation necessarily hasn't been an issue for mental health. It's really that the representations haven't been representative. You know, for other minority groups, quantity was the problem, say the trans community. There really were no depictions of trans people until very recently. For mental health, that lack of quantity hasn't been the problem, it's really a lack of quality. Yeah. You know, there have been representations of people with mental illnesses in comics for going on 8 decades now. But by and large, those representations are not representative of people actually living with mental health issues. And they've become actually rather stigmatizing and have had an effect on people, or theoretically, one can argue they've had an effect on people the same way that other other things that contribute to stigma have an effect on people with mental illnesses. So that's why I created Aura. Very proud of it. If you'd like a copy, again, they should be floating around. So let Eric pick up here.
Eric, I'm curious. Other than creating your own works to help in positive representations, do you think there's anything that the media can do, or are we?
All right, I do. I think we can stop approaching stories about mental illness and characters with mental illness. We can stop approaching them as a very special episodes. An aspect of a person, it doesn't define a person. If we look back at representation of minority groups, African Americans, Asians, gay community, when they were first represented and depicted in mainstream media, they were often depicted in ways that
perpetuated stereotypes.
And what's happened, though, there was a natural ongoing evolution that still continues. A maturation in the way that those populations were depicted. That has not happened in mental health. We're still stuck in these very stigmatizing images and stuck with things that perpetuate stereotypes. We need to have that evolution, that maturity.
Giving people's testimony to Project UROK, UROK, okay.
And I'd like Jenny Jaffe to share her thoughts in school.
Hey, friends. I'm Jenny Jaffe, the founder of Project UROK, and I'm also a person who lives with mental illness, and I'm also a person who consumes media, like probably too much media. And here are the things that I'm really interested in, right? One, giving people control over their own narratives. I think that what is ignored when it comes to mental illness a lot of the time is the fact that there's not one experience of mental illness. Mental illness exists at so many intersections. Mental illness exists in so many different forms. And I think I'm really interested in creating a platform, which I hope a part of your okay is, where people feel comfortable sharing their stories. And what I think the media has a responsibility to do, what I think the media can do, is it can reflect to us the world it wishes to create. And I think with pop culture especially, and with stories that are consumed by young people, the media has a tremendous amount of responsibility, not just to represent mental illness, but to try and handle it in a way that you handle the story of any other human being. And it's exactly what was being said before. It's mental illness doesn't look like a sad black and white episode where it's like somebody like staying in bed all day, like staring out the window. Sometimes that's what it feels like. Most of the time it's people sitting in a room at Comic-Con, sitting on a panel at Comic-Con, feeling like they're about to barf, because so many people are looking at them. I'm interested in the words we choose, why we choose them, what we say and what we don't say. Upstairs, when you're about to go into Artist Alley, there's a big sign. And it says, welcome to the largest insane asylum on the East Coast. Mm. What's up with that?
Vargas, who is another tremendous activist, works with the community for promoting awareness of representation, issues in representation and mental health. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on this as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Just to give a little background about what I do, I've been an activist, feminist activist, for many years, and I recently decided that I wanted to focus on mental health. I identify as a suicide attempt survivor, and I also live with depression and anxiety. And so I always wondered, why wasn't I tackling that issue through my activism? And so I started a project that I titled the People of Color and Mental Illness Quota Project. I wanted to create a space where communities of color and overall marginalized communities could share their stories and express themselves. I think that when it comes to community representation and mental illness, it's usually excluding people of color, which can be very invalidating and isolating. And growing up Latina, if I had seen more representations of people who look like me, I wouldn't have felt so alone. And so I wanted to create that space. And also just change the way that we talk about mental illness. We always talk about it in a way where some way like garners pity, or you know, we're constantly suffering from. And there's so many people who are thriving and who are living meaningful, amazing lives. And like, how many articles have you seen where the photos is of someone clutching their head? Like, how many times am I like this? I don't do that all the time, and it's really funny the way that we represent mental illness. And so through Project UROK's work, which I'm very happy to be part of, I'm able to continue to diversify the representation of mental illness. And so I'm just so happy to be here and so happy to be among such amazing people who want to be talking about these issues. The more we talk about them, the less stigma there will be. And so thank you so much.
Well, I have a ton of questions to ask them, but as I promised, it is our belief, you know, this is a time that has, there are unparalleled opportunities for you to have influence, for you to have a voice. And so if you have any questions, I'd like to open it up early. There's a microphone over here, and we would love to hear from you.
I love this.
Hello?
Yes.
Thank you for being with the panel. You know, as you showed with the Gotham clip, you know, very common portrayal of mental illnesses is that's being violent or dangerous. But you, just as prevalent, I think it is maybe a more subtle bias that people with mental illness, you can't take what they say seriously, or you can discount it because they're just crazy, they're just unstable, and you can't really, you know, their perception is so skewed that it's not worth anything. And that's, I think, something that creates so much more stigma, you know, everywhere, in the workplace, in social life, because you can see when somebody finds out that somebody has mental illness, their whole way of interacting with that person changes, and then their whole, you know. And so I wonder what can be done to change that more subtle perception.
It's a great question. Thank you for asking that. I, among the populations I work with patients with chronic pain disorder. And chronic pain, a lot of times, also brings up other difficulties, mental health difficulties, such as anxiety or depression. And one can certainly trigger the other. And unfortunately, I've seen that in doctors and also other families, for example, where they will say, oh, it's just your anxiety talking. And it's really, really unfortunate. So one of the things that we can do is provide more information for the patient's families, for other providers. The hospital that I'm working on, they actually just commissioned me to write a comic book specifically for chronic pain and some of the other issues that it brings up. So we're working on distributing those materials, and I think more than anything, education.
When I worked on the wards, I worked for quite a few years in a brain test job, and it was about 7 years without highly completed. My nurse trainer decided to functioning system. So I just suffered very severe anxiety, depression, self-dementia. So I have seen kind of both from both sides of the table. I'm on my own with that strikes me as a phrase that people remember as a song. Not just the older people who are dismissed from the service, it's a baby Sabbath program for Smithfield. And Kambam, one of the things I try to tell people is not to let the mental illness define the time. It's not kind of your job to be mentally ill. You have to, you can reach beyond that. I do a chapter in a book about Brian Wilson and other famous people who are about mental illness. And yeah, I've gone on to contribute massively to society around either the political means or creative means, or music in this case. So it's, you suffer from mental illness, it's the first hurdle, one of the first hurdles you must go, is not to write yourself for. And so it's society at large shouldn't write mental illness.
Thank you so much for that very important question.
That was a great question, by the way. I think it hits the at the heart of the statement, right? So there's a societal level of statement where you know studies, people don't want to live near someone, don't want to have a friend or employment for all the reasons you said, obviously. There's also a self-statement where people start feeling bad about having to listen to themselves. You see it in real life. Like, I told an anecdote about this before. But I think that's the heart of it. So how do you change that? You can do a lot of the different things that people have talked about, but where does it come from? Well, one thing is it comes in a slow, insidious way. You don't realize it comes to patients, you know. And if you don't talk about mental illness, you don't have information out there. So the only information you get is from things like what we just saw. And you don't have an intuitive sense of, you know, how to reference that. We know a man can fly, so Superman doesn't throw us off. You know, it's fancy, it's nice. But this actually has an impact. It's not just a PC argument. It actually has real world impacts on people. And that's the root of it.
I think like most things, people are afraid that they don't understand. Mm-hmm. And I do think that's why we need more information. How do you envision stigma being reduced when mental illness currently seems to be a topic worth discussing socially and especially politically during situations of tragedy in our society? And what education efforts or mediums specifically do you think the media can play in progressive efforts to help reduce this, especially, I don't know, it just makes me angry, especially with the political climate, especially what happened in Portland. That's when it seems to be relevant to discuss such issues.
Another important question, and I'm wondering if you see this one.
So, who watched last week's John Oliver show? Okay, so John Oliver addressed the issue of the misperceived relationship between violence and mental illness, and I think it was an excellent commentary on it. There's a bit of a kind of how do I say this? Some advocates, unfortunately, speak out of both sides of their mouths on this issue because there is a problem with accessing mental health care. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Things could definitely be improved. And how do you get people to care about that? You know, so there's a natural kind of bandwagoning when it comes to tragedies like this. Fortunately, only about 4% of violent crime is attributable to mental illness. Not something that is representative of somebody with a mental disorder, but that's the general perception. And how do you get that perception? Well, again, it's my strong belief that media representations play a role in our perceptions of people with mental health disorders and violence, right? I mean, when, again, I don't want to harp on this too much, but we saw a clip of what is really, I think, representative of Hollywood's, for the past, you know, for the majority of the history of film and television, what Hollywood's depiction of mental health is. And how do we change that? It's a slow, slow process that begins with demanding that representations of mental illness and people with mental disorders are more accurate and less stigmatizing and not sensationalized.
And I saw some other heads nodding at the end of the table. Anybody else want to jump in on this?
I think there's something really interesting that happens when it comes to we decide who gets to be portrayed as having mental illness too. I think that it's really important that this is something I personally do. I understand why people aren't comfortable. I think the phrase mental illness is avoided. And I think we talk about people who are really successful with mental illness as having a mental health issue, or kind of just saying it in a nicer way. I think that there's nothing wrong with mental illness, and if there's truly nothing wrong with mental illness, like, you should be able to say, I have mental illness. The fact that the phrase mental illness is only invoked in the wake of a white guy shooting someone, it is bullshit. and one thing that I feel like here on the project are okay is I think that sometimes there are acceptable mental illnesses and there are mental illnesses we don't talk about. There are no unacceptable mental illnesses. The end of conversation. We talk, it is, we are all under the same umbrella, we're all fighting for each other. That's how I feel.
Try to get everybody on the line. You know, it's often an impossible task of these things, but we're going to do our best. So thank you again. That was another thoughtful question, and it was duplicative, so thank you so much.
No, thank you very much. And if I could just say, I think Claire Danes' depiction of her character in Homeland, I think she did a really good job, and I think that kind of shows more accurate portrayal. Thank you so much.
No, very good. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Actually, that's kind of a good segue for my question. Because in addition to writing about pop culture, I also am working towards writing television. And I have a question about a specific portrayal, and then a question about creating characters. The specific portrayal being, I watched Empire, and one of the brothers on that show is bipolar. And I thought it was an interesting kind of look at that because, you know, as we've mentioned, like in communities of color, a lot of the times mental health issues are seen as like a white person problem, and they kind of address that on the show. But then they also have him kind of purposely going off his meds and kind of doing all this other stuff. And I just wanted to know, one, how you felt about that portrayal. But in a larger context, when creating characters for television or for any media, a lot of the times in the interest of creating positive representations, you have like the magical perfect people who are like inspirational or like, you know, what have you. And then like anytime that they do something wrong or villainous or whatever, it's kind of like seen as negative because, you know, we want positive portrayals. And it's like sometimes people are assholes. Like, you know, and that's also accurate. So one, how do you feel about the portrayal in Empire? And two, how can we create balanced portrayals that are accurate, but also don't, like, you know, make people magically perfect?
I'm really glad that you brought up Empire. We had a whole chat about it, and I think that it really resonated with a lot of people when Cookie says, oh, well, that's a white person thing. And I was like, that's exactly not what it is. So many people live with mental illness. Mental illness does not discriminate. Everyone lives with it. And so I think that it was, you know, considering it was pretty good, I think that it showed that there are times where you do get off your meds. There are so many times I got off my meds because I didn't want to do it anymore. I felt like, why do I have to continue taking meds so that I could be like my ideal self? Like, it's a very frustrating thing. Through my work, I try not to represent myself as someone who is this perfect, totally recovered human being. And so through that representation shows that you're always in recovery. There's not just your recovery, you're done, and it's over. It's like, it's an ongoing process. And it doesn't matter where you are in recovery, as long as you're in it, and as long as you know you're doing your best, I think that's the most important thing. And yeah, there are assholes everywhere, so, you know, the assholes could have messed up with us, may not. And so it's interesting to have those different portrayals of mental illness, and so I'm really glad you brought that up.
Other thoughts?
Maybe when writing about a character with mental illness, it may be helpful to consult with a mental health professional. That's something that a lot of us in this field are now doing and always very happy to do. So I think I'm happy that more writers are doing that, and I'm hoping that Kambam will get a word of that too.
My question is a little bit more reality as opposed to media, because my life pretty much is surrounded by mental illness. My wife, who has anxiety disorders and OCD, I am afraid right now, I'm so hard on anxiety, but I am afraid of yard complexes and hate talking in front of large people. But more so with my cousin, she is bipolar, diagnosed bipolar. She is every couple of years, she actually has a doctor, she checks herself in. And she asked me to ask, do you have any recommendations about what she felt like, about how she can inform work when she actually has to be out for this? And also she's having issues with childcare, and her husband keeps throwing the mental illness thing at the judge and having issues with that. Or something like that.
I know this is we're having a series of really important questions here from writing to representations. I know that the Vargas folks, thought folks, are friends with psychiatrists. And do you have any thoughts on that at the board?
So that's a really complicated question. We can talk more in details afterwards, but just try to be brief. Let me start with court. Yes, ministerials, judges will look at someone's mental illness, but the thing that we really try to emphasize is how does that affect the function? Okay. We have all of us have different health issues. How does it affect your functioning? And that's what we look at. Let's say you broke your leg, and let's say your job is talking on the phone, right? How does it affect your job functioning? It's the same way for mental illnesses, okay? So that's the first thing I'd say, but it is a real issue. And, you know, unfortunately, some legal system or politically appointed offices, and people have kind of individual biases, especially on the lower community level. They have certain, they're affected by stigma just like other people. And they think that, you know, this is going to be really dangerous for the kid because of those mental illness. Maybe this person's going to be unstable because of mental illness. And that's on a structural level, in the legal court system, we have to kind of fight those things. You know, we're talking about media creation, but that's a source of stigma as well. And then what were the other two?
How to approach work, like when talking to them, because of stigma, it's just like the action.
You don't have to reveal anything. There's a family that will do that. Most places, you don't have to reveal it. You just have to get a doctor to know who's done these kinds of things that are treating folks as well. Sometimes, rarely, there's need a diagnosis code. You know, there's ways to kind of code it away or something. So it's really up to the person. But you know, the more of us that say that here's why I'm going to work, the less it's going to be stigmatized. I think. I mean, we have the power to do that. I understand why you might want to hide in a different climate, but I'm just encouraging everyone to just put it out there. You know, the world will change.
This is definitely one of those things where there's speaking in general and sort of action and empowerment, and then there are also some very interesting strategies that I think we can use within the court and in the workplace. And I think that's also when we wind up talking with your psychiatric professionals and legal professionals to give you a little bit more sort of the tactical aspects of that beyond the general stuff we're talking here. So I think that is definitely something very, very well worth pursuing. So thank you for that excellent question.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hi. So I just want to ask more of a question. Oh wait, you have my voice, that's weird. The supervisor therapy thing, it just surprised me because I was in a doctoral program 10 years years ago. I didn't get my doctorate. I am a licensed therapist with my master's, but one of the reasons I didn't get it, I think, is I was very into geek culture, and I would talk with geek culture with my clients who are mostly teens, and I was told by my supervisor, don't do that. They have to live in the real world. And I was told really, like, why are you wearing your Buffy sweatshirt? Don't do that. People will think you're still an adolescent. So I'm really glad that's changing. But I think one of the many reasons that even though I'm not a licensed therapist, I quit and I just want to be a writer. And I think it's because I felt like you couldn't do those things, you couldn't be yourself. And there's very much a separation of us and them. And I have PTSD, I have depression. I was open about it, and meanwhile, all the other graduate students and supervisors, they would never identify. So I guess my question is that changing, and how do we make a change?
I want to talk to Vixen a little bit about this, because you've been taking the lead in helping people see the need for change. Do you think things are changing, or I'd love to hear your thoughts.
You're not gonna see it. It's, I don't know. It takes 9 months for a child to perform, so I'm just gonna use that as an example as to how things are changing. But if I multiply that by pi, it's really, really slow. And as far as you mentioned teenagers and geek culture and everything like that, I am a Trexler and Repetitions. When I was younger, I was abused by adults. And for me, the only thing that helped me, I tried to kill myself, like, I don't know, so many times, but comics, Miss Marvel, well, Captain Marvel, was way back in the 80s. She was raped and forced to have a kid and all that other stuff. I was already kind of in that same situation, and me reading those comics made me rethink about killing myself probably like after the fifth or sixth time. So the comic helped me get out of my dark place. And I would never, if a child wants to read something and it speaks to them, love them reading. It's not going to make them even worse. I mean, I don't understand. I just don't understand that. Because if I didn't read this book, I wouldn't hear talking to you today. I know that for a fact.
And we want a therapist to talk about in therapy and to use it. And, yes. You know, I think everybody agrees on it, but then how do we get up to the academics that are still running the doctoral programs and all of, you know.
I know that's something that Janina's been working with, so I'm wondering if you could put your
voice. Maybe I'm looking at it from my rosy colored glasses, but it looks like things are changing, at the very least in the mental health field, at the very least within psychology. More universities are now starting to incorporate some comics into therapy. There are several universities that have geek culture as a multicultural elective, the university where I'm teaching being one of them. And more private practices are incorporating superheroes in therapy, which is really, really cool. And I think more than anything, it's the fact that you guys have a voice. Just like when, I think it was last year when DC had some of those sexist shirts, do you guys remember? Like, my boyfriend is a superhero. And there was this big outrage, and the next day they pulled the shirts down and started making more merchandise for women. That shows that we have a voice. And similarly, we're now seeing that in the mental health profession. There are more and more comic books and even treatment manuals that are written by psychologists. The VA actually just hired me last month to write a comic book for them for our veterans with PTSD. There are multiple avenues now where this is happening, maybe not as fast as we'd like, and maybe not fast enough for everyone to see, but it is happening, and you guys are in charge of that. You guys have a voice, and the more you speak out, the more you write, the more you purchase these things, the more of this is going to be available. So you guys are in charge of this.
And here's even the books that you read. They're written by creators who suffer from mental illnesses. Scott's Snyder has spoken out so many times that he suffers from depression, anxiety, and everything. And just the fact that writing Batman, it helps get him into whatever place that he's in. So while he might not realize it, there's so many people who suffer from mental illnesses. We just have to, just listen to that. We're not contagious.
I want to throw Eric Dubo.
I'm feeling you can come up.
Okay. All right. The next question. Thank you again.
Hi. Thanks. It's been great hearing the panel. I'm a mother of an otaku. I am painting the beginning and from the beginning. And this is my pet passion, is advocating for people with mental illness. And I'm just as curious. Well, one of the things I've been working on is trying to help people get off psych medication, and there's no protocols really from these drug companies to get off these medications. I mean, what do you feel about the book, Anatomy of an Epidemic, which talks about the relationship between the rise and people on SSI with mental illness and the use of psych medication in treating illness?
I mean, we're providers, so I view medications as one tool in the various things we can do for people. And I think it has to be thoughtful, obviously, and it needs to fit what you're trying to do, right? So using medications for, let's say, you have a heart attack and now we're trying to reduce your risk, that may be something that's think about the risk and benefits. So similarly with psychiatric medicines, there are certain conditions where it may be useful on medication. And you have to weigh those risks and benefits. And that's a conversation you have with your doctor and your personal values. There's also other conditions that are probably over-medicated right now in this diagnosis. And that's a failure of the system right now. So I don't think me personally, from my experience, I don't think I can make a blanket statement and say that medications are always bad. Sometimes those are things that keep people together. Go off and actually causes the damage in their life. There's other people that are improperly on medications, and it's probably bad for them to be on those. So I think it's like a dual facet issue. That's just my opinion. So I
think it's definitely something you want to talk with your doctor yourself about.
Did you read that book?
I've read some of the book.
I just want to interject. There are times that when you feel good and you're on your medications and you feel out of control, don't stop taking it. Seriously.
Hello. So it's not just mental health issues that get poorly portrayed in pop culture. It's also mental health professionals. I mean, Harley Quinn, Spellbinder, the entirety of Arkham Asylum. To what degree is addressing the portrayal of mental health professionals part of using pop culture for good?
Another good question.
I think it's a huge degree. If you see someone on TV and they're portrayed terribly, you're not going to want to go see someone in that field. Most people now have at least one television in the home. That's going to be a source of information. So if you see somebody dodgy, why would you run there? Ideally, you want to have someone, when people call me, I'm a psychiatrist, but I have a psychotherapy-based practice, and medications are needed, it's done in context of seeing people. My goal is to understand people, help them understand themselves. That means talking about things that connect with them, whether that's comics, whether that's pop culture, books, 18th century literature, I don't know much about that, but I'll try to figure it out. So, you want to connect, and you need better portrayals of people to know you can connect with somebody. Somebody can understand.
And
you're right. And you can talk.
I just want to say really quickly, the trope of the evil psychiatrist is so tired. I mean, like, how many times can that be done? You know, it's just lazy writing, is what my opinion is. Tropes are tropes because they work to some degree. You know, but it's been done. And I think it's so transparent now that I don't think that people really think that anymore. And you know, there's all kinds of other misrepresentations when it comes to mental health systems, and you know, we're all forensic psychiatrists, and when it comes to people in the forensic system and the criminal justice system, those who are acquitted, not guilty by reason of insanity, especially, there's so much misunderstanding of what that is, and that actually can play into the legal outcomes of people who are actually pleading not guilty by reason of insanity, because jurors have these misperceptions. They think that somebody who is found not guilty by reason of insanity is getting off scot-free and is then going to be, you know, lurking in their neighborhood waiting to kill them. And that's obviously fraught with misinformation, but you know, that it comes from somewhere.
I want to put it in Mara. Mara, in addition to being a writer and playwright, is also an actress. And I wonder if you have any thoughts about this blurring the line between representation and reality.
I think that not only is it easy to dehumanize, as you were saying, it's hack. I think that that's bad writing, to dehumanize, to reduce somebody to a caricature. I also think that there is a lot of, like as you were saying, there is a lot of misunderstanding in the media of what, you know, a mentally ill person is and what a mentally ill person will do, and that it's sort of a not in my backyard kind of thing. I don't, you know, okay, these people are fine when we're on TV or on our, you know, oh, they must be the people who are committing crimes I hear about on the news, but I, you know, people are afraid of these people, are afraid of these fake representations in real life as well. I think what people don't realize is that people with mental illness are around them all the time. That they are surrounded by, they are their friends, they are their family, it's just that nobody ever talks about it. But I do think that addressing it and bringing it up and naming it is really the most important step.
Hi, you mentioned earlier that, as you all know, this is not a matter of a lack of representation, just poor representation. And I'm just going to use Batman as an example, because I grew up on Batman. I love Batman, but it also is an egregious example. Copious amount of fatalism, and I feel like we want to excise the ableism from Batman, in fact, to remove half his rogues gallery in the entirety of Arkham Asylum. And I'm just wondering, what I don't know what to hope or expect from a writer who's handed off who's handed a Batman project if they don't want to necessarily utilize those elements, or because they're not going to get rid of them. So is there any way to salvage this?
Excellent question. Any thoughts?
I think there's something that happens when you start calling stuff out in pop culture, and everybody has a, oh, that wasn't my fault. Like, I didn't make that call type of thing. Here's the thing. Systems happen at every step down every line. So even when you're taking on a long-running series, and I'm not 100% sure how it works within a big comic corporation, but I worked in television. I worked in a lot of different big corporate comedy places. Like, I know how notes happen. I know how many people everything goes through. And I just think everybody within every system needs to look at their place in it. I think that's true of every system in place. That's true of racist systems, patriarchy. Everybody looks through themselves and what they're allowed to continue. And I think when you're in a position within an organization and continuing a series, you get to basically say, like, listen, like, I know this isn't all going to change overnight. What if we just alter this one thing? I think it would be awesome if, like, you know, I'm not saying, like, get rid of the entire rogues galleries, because those are some great villains, but get some, like, police officers in there, like, the good Gotham cops. I guess, guys, please don't judge me for my Batman knowledge. But, like, you know, you gotta have somebody in there who's, like, this person's a good character, and he's also got the exact same diagnosis as one of the villains. They do something totally different with it. I saw the Iron Giant the other day. I think that has some great stuff to say about what you do with circumstances you're given. Great movie. Cried a lot.
We talk a lot about leaving their mark on a character, leaving their mark on mythology. And I think even with so much interaction between creators and consumers, there's a chance for everybody to make that mark. So that's a good question. Next question, please.
Hi,
Hi, thank you. I'm actually a mental health professional myself, so I was really looking forward to this panel because I wanted to learn how to incorporate key culture into my work a lot. I use it a lot to build relationships with my patients. I have like 70, so they see it all over my office, so they always, it's always a big talking point. But I've been doing a lot of research with my research groups and also doing individual therapy. I want to see how I can help them with various mental health situations. So I was wondering if there's any trainings or manuals or books that I could read to start to build this stuff out for myself.
I have a book coming out next year, Superhero Therapy. It's going to be a treatment manual that will hopefully be helpful for both therapists and also consumers in how to incorporate fictional characters into therapy.
Thank you.
And also, I heard the broadcast about that you were not read the New York Times a while back after that. It's frustration. We're beginning to see this, right? And I know I'm looking at the time. It's almost 4:45. And I just want to say something here. There are a couple of folks that I think there's a panelist meeting to get to the airport, and so if they disappear in a few minutes, that really is why they have to go. And if anybody else is going to get to the airport, we certainly understand. But I had spoken to the folks at Repop earlier, and they said there's a good chance that we'd be able to stay over a little bit and accommodate these questions. So unless I hear otherwise, we're just going to keep going. So thank you so much. Thanks, by the way, good folks at Repop for the audience. Next question.
As someone who is managing anxiety and depression, a big part of overcoming those conditions is having a good support system. And a lot of times the stigmas that we see in culture fit into our support systems, family, friends, spouses. What can someone that's living with mental health do to help alter the stigmas that their support system?
It's difficult. I mean, when you live with a mental illness, it's not just you, it's your internal family who is affected by it. And so it can be very hard to kind of discuss these issues with them or be able to really understand. So definitely talking about it using I statements, like, this is how I feel versus, you maybe feel this way. I think that can do a lot in terms of talking about these really serious issues with your family. I think also in some way kind of trying to relate to them. And personally, my mom, and I know she lives with depression, but she's been diagnosed, she still lives with it. And trying to have those conversations with her and just kind of saying, well, wasn't there a time when you felt really alone, when you felt like you couldn't talk to anyone about your feelings? And kind of saying, well, this is what I'm trying to do now. I'm trying to stop this cycle of silence. I want to be able to talk to you about these issues. And I think that can really do a lot in terms of the relationship you have with your family.
Thank you so very much. Next question, please.
My question is from MizCaramelVixen.
Yes, my MizCaramelVixen.
You were talking earlier about how you had panic attacks during the time as you were walking through. How do you calm down? How do you deal with it?
Oh, with panic attacks?
Yeah.
For me, I have to be in a different. I have to get out from where I am. I need to have a corner. A bathroom stall, under the table. I need to get away and get my mind right. And also, the monitoring does help a lot. I don't know about it, but panic attacks happen. There's nothing that you can do about it to stop it. It has to run its course, and it's really exhausting when you have that breakdown. At that time, it's the end of the world, and it's not like your brain knows, okay, chill out, but it just doesn't register, so you have to just, you gotta give yourself a moment and just get away and just sit and
dark, close your eyes, or whatever. And yes, you're still grounded. I love you. Next question.
Hi. First of all, I want to thank you for pointing out that asylum sign by Artist Alley. I've been seeing it for 4 days, and it's like, so thanks for mentioning it, because I've been mentioning it to everybody around me.
Thank you for mentioning it.
Yeah. And that kind of got me thinking about the way that mental illness sells. And the way that we look at stuff, our asylum has been mentioned like 3 times already. We look at that, we look at like American Horror Story, Asylum, and all of these like titles or ways that we use, especially hospitalization, as like a spooky or like wacky way that like other characters who are totally, you know, not mentally ill can come into these like weird situations. And I guess I'm asking, like, how do you deal with that, with the marketing side, and with the sad fact that like we are being used to sell like normative storylines?
I think that mental illness is scary as like a story because it's misunderstood, and because it's been misunderstood for so long that, you know, asylums, all these things are things that happen in real life to some extent because we didn't understand how to take care of it. And I think that it is sort of this idea of something that's other and out of control and scary and mysterious. I think that there's definitely an air to mystery about it. And I think that when we start demystifying it and talking about it more and saying, no, it's not somebody, you know, in an asylum, it's people living day to day, sometimes having good days, sometimes having bad days, maybe taking medication, maybe not. You know, however they choose to deal with it in their own individual ways, in their own individual communities, is that. And I think when people start seeing that, that will change.
Yeah, American Horror Story, girl convinces herself to take a shower when it would have been as popular. but here's the thing. I think it's the same answer as people asking, like, how do you deal with your comedian in like PC culture? Get more creative. Sort of old trope, old well to dig back from, like, maybe the problem is that you can't think of anything else scary. But I would totally love to do a comic where stuff I actually find scary, like elevators and balloons popping and so on.
Interesting. It's inherently interesting. That's why I went into the field. and you can do a lot of good, and there's a lot of groundbreaking work that can still be done in the field of mental health. So, you know, it's not a subject that I think that we should shy away from. I think that we should be mindful of how we depict people with mental illnesses and, you know, not, again, resort to lazy tropes and so forth. And also, I just want to add that it doesn't mean that we have to abandon depictions of mental illness. So, you know, earlier someone mentioned Arkham. Yeah, they, you know, Warner Brothers makes a lot of money off of Arkham Asylum. You know, does that mean that it has to go away as if it didn't exist? I don't know the answer to that question, but I do know that representations of women in comics have improved light years in recent years. And that, you know, that it's possible to have representations that are positive and accurate and not stigmatizing and be successful with them.
It's been rewarding for us to work with writers and have them say, wow, it's really added layers to my character. And not in a bad way or not in a superficial way, but it's a part of the character that just wasn't explored before. That's been helpful. It's not about political correctness. It's about understanding.
And I hope this is inspiring some of you to think about writing and creating your own works and being your own voice and expressing how you think what you think of positive representation. So thank you so much. Thank you so much. Next question.
So I'm gonna start with maybe my last question. I have an incredibly difficult time asking for help with depression, and I sought out a care specialist, and I've actually been told, oh well, you can go to work, so there really is nothing wrong with you. Mm-hmm. And you know, I kind of was gonna ask, you know, how do you feel that the healthcare system needs to change, even more for, you know, people who may not seek out help because they're either afraid to, they don't understand what they're feeling, they don't. You know, maybe
that doesn't exist, that's not real,
you're making
up,
you're
being
dramatic.
You know,
how does the healthcare system need to change to address everyone?
I think we can solve that in 6 minutes. But it's important, so we're thinking, we're seeing this now, with lots of different questions, like with police, with the handling of domestic violence, and now all
the same mission. Were you any thoughts on this? I think quad
question. Okay, it was how do you think the mental healthcare system has changed in order to address. So,
how do you think the mental healthcare system needs to change in order to address people who may need the help but don't really maybe know how to go about it, or they feel shamed, or they just, they're being told something different. They're, you know, they go and get more, they try to seek the help, and they're being told, hey, you're okay.
That's kind of
difficult. Okay. So there's a sense that people feel like they're trying to find their current mental health system, healthcare system, will be unresponsive, either saying that, oh, you're okay, you don't have to worry about it, or putting them in situations where they're feeling afraid of treatment. How do you think that the health, do you see any room for improvement in the mental health care system?
There's always been a room. I mean, that has to change as a scientist. Been a gradual improvement. I mean, it's been a glacial change. It's so slow. But even like two steps forward and one step back is still progress. And we're seeing sort of, we need to get more information out there about the all areas of society. Is this the first part of the
matter? This is the first part of your comment, and it was also in San Diego. So
we need this kind of thing to be like a regular thing. Crazy people generally drive this hard analysis really to understand how they help them better, and especially as someone said earlier, to talk to people who have the skills to inform them. No one can cross up to like this, the gospel.
It's interesting to raise the question that the need for education goes beyond comics, it goes beyond film. It's all society in the way that comics can actually, like psychiatric panels, can help create awareness and change things that are there. Next question.
Hi. So I know earlier you guys mentioned
the big problem is people really don't understand mental illness. And I was thinking about it, and I recently heard that they were adding consent education along with sexual education. And I thought, do you guys have any opinions on if we should start introducing the idea of mental illness and how it's like okay to like be sad sometimes or anything like that, but to children so that you don't have the whole categorization of mental illnesses. Because, you know, sometimes if you're told you have an illness by a healthcare professional, you kind of sometimes might play up to it. I know I have a friend who was perfectly fine, functional, was happy, and then by some weird circumstance, he got diagnosed as mildly autistic, and he subconsciously, like, started acting far more autistic than he actually was. And I was wondering if you guys thought that it would be a good idea to introduce it, perhaps like as comics or as like children's books.
I think that one thing that I want to say to hear too is that it isn't just people like me with traditional mental illness that necessarily always need mental health care. It's not always that, and mental illness can look like different things, but sometimes people just need somebody to talk to, and I think mental health care can be a place for people to go. That is some place people can reach out and they can get help. And I think that that's something that also needs to be stigmatized, you know, mental illness as well as this. Or hey, maybe you don't have this, but it's good to be going to this anyway. It's good for you to have that outreach anyway. I think that those are things that both need to be stigmatized. I do think that there's media out there that's doing it. I think Inside Out was a good example of something that showed that, hey, you're gonna be sad sometimes, and that's okay. And I do think that getting that message across, especially to children, like you're gonna feel things, and like what you were saying about anxiety attacks, you just have to get through them. It's riding under a false alarm. You just have to get through them and you'll be fine. And I think that that is a very important message that I'm glad that Inside Out, you know, I think I really hope that Inside Out sort of paves the way for more conversations and more media in that way.
And we're gonna go to the last question, because I know we're going to, but I know Dior has been doing a lot of work in White House recognition, and I think there's tremendous potential for this sort of thing to go sort of beyond this room, adult culture, into our school system. And from where I'm thinking, quick thoughts before we move to the final question.
I'm sorry, could you phrase that?
In terms of making this work, sort of normalizing this, making this part of education for our youth as well as for adults.
Right, I mean, I'm always very much focused on prevention and talking about these issues and also just validating people's feelings. I mean, if you're sad, it's okay. Like, I'm not going to tell you that what you're feeling, you know, and you should be able to let people talk and express themselves. And so definitely prevention, you know, talking about it in workplaces. It really annoys me. They have Weight Watchers programs in workplaces, but do they have mental health programs in place? They care more about how we look versus how we feel. And it's really frustrating.
We promised that everyone would get to ask the questions, so this is our final question.
I'll make it very brief. Well, I guess earlier in the week I had a panel where they talked about like the difference between having representation, even if it's not so positive, and then having no representation at all. And I know for me, having struggled with my whole life with many different issues, I always kind of found something really comforting about even if the representation wasn't fully 100% accurate, just to know that like maybe I'm not quite, in my head I would think that like maybe I'm just as crazy as like Harley Quinn, but then like it's nice when you kind of see the representation there and you're like, oh, I'm actually not that crazy, or like you're kind of crazy. And there's something kind of comforting about having sort of those outrageous personalities to kind of balance out a lot. So I guess I'm kind of just wondering, as the last question, sort of your thoughts on the relationship between kind of authenticity and kind of hyper-exaggeration, kind of what can be done more to sort of make things or whether it's a good thing to kind of have representation, regardless of how exaggerated it may be, or whether it's better to work towards just straight up positive, I guess, if that makes sense.
Thoughts?
say that humor is a mature defense mechanism, okay? And when there are ways to treat mental illness, depict mental illness and mental health issues with humor, because we need to laugh at ourselves sometimes. But when those depictions become harmful or contribute to negative stereotypes, that's when I would say, maybe it's better not to have it than to have it. But that falls into a trap. This isn't an either-or thing. We don't have to say we don't want representation versus we accept bad representation. We can work towards having more accurate, less stigmatizing representation and not, forcing anyone out of anything. So I think that that's a shift in how we think about things. Again, I think it's been done with other minority groups, certainly again with the representation of women in comics especially, and we can do this.
And with that, a very rich, complex, and important topic. You are not alone, and even though the New York Comic Con is ending, this conversation is not. And I encourage all of you to keep in touch with us via Twitter, via social media, via email, whatever. I hope you will thank our panelists for being here.